you.
They not ready. Welcome to Real Talk Radio, the show that says just because you don't attend with them does not mean that you're not in him. The him man Jesus. The show that plants seeds and waters seeds, but God gives the increase. Let's talk about it on Real Talk Radio. This show is a continuation of the church folk revolution. Enjoy the show.
Knick-knack, Cadillac, 2000, out of time. Welcome, 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 ladies and gentlemen. Exciting episode of Real Talk Radio. Today is April 12th, 2015, and we are live. We are live on Real Talk. Today, continuing our conversation from last week where we talked about what's wrong with the church. Sometimes people, they're talking about the negative stuff. What's right with the church? What's right with the church? Well, that ain't what we're talking about today. There are some good things that happen in church, so please don't take that. We are speaking in general terms, so please understand we are not talking about your church unless we are talking about your church. So we are speaking in generalities here, but we got a lot of stuff to cover today. Couldn't get it all in last week. So let's hit it. Let's hit it. You ready, fellas?
Ready, ready, ready.
Ready, Rob. Going
to let
my friend us in, Rob?
I wouldn't mind, actually. I wouldn't mind doing that at all.
Cool.
Right. Most gracious and heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for this opportunity to come before your people, Lord, to discuss a yet another important topic, Father, and we hope that it helps someone this morning to evaluate some things that may be going on at their particular assembly that will cause them to weigh the situation, Father, whether or not they need to be in that assembly or not. And just want to bring light to this subject as we always do, and as always, it's always about you, Father, never about us. Again, we thank you and worship your name. Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. You want to give your opening thoughts, John? Go ahead and get some opening thoughts, man.
Hey, come back to me. Somebody else go.
Oh, boy.
Go ahead, Rob.
Mute your lines. You taking a bath or something, man? Because that's disturbing on the air. But what's wrong with the institutional church, man? What's wrong with the church, man? I mean, we didn't have enough time to get into everything last week, man. I mean, we got into a lot of the spiritual aspect of it, and we're going to continue with that today. And we're also going to get into, and I think we tried to touch on it last week, we're going to get into the physical aspect of it, meaning the building itself, what goes into maintaining a building, what goes into the services. You know, we've done a show about the order of service. We're probably going to talk about that a little bit today. And just bring more light to it, man. You know, what's wrong with the church? What's wrong with the institutional church system? I'm pretty sure we'll probably touch on the word church. You know, and John, you're very versed in the origins of that word as it's translated in the scripture. I'm pretty sure we'll touch on that because that weighs heavily into this discussion as well. So those are my opening thoughts, man. Run with it.
Dr. Dre, what's up, bro?
Hey, what's going on, y'all? Well, my opening thoughts about it is, basically, no, we did not get a chance to go into to everything because this is such a vast subject for us. I mean, you know, it's no one thing, and you know, if we were to touch down on one particular thing, you know, there's so many facets to cover, and it was way too much for one show. You know, so there's, you know, there's some more things that, you know, like Rob touched on, definitely the order of service, you know, what's wrong with the order of service, a lot of different things like, you know, the twist in the scripture, the equating of the church with Jesus. In other words, you know, how if you, what's the best way to explain that? If you notice, you have a lot of people who would do everything that they possibly can to get you to church, okay? But they won't do anything to bring you to Jesus. You understand what I'm saying? A lot of times, you know, there's a distinction between the church and who the church is, the actual church building, and the things that go on in the church building, and who Jesus Christ is. And for some reason or another, there are people who have blurred those lines. They have blurred it to the point where if you're talking about the church, you're actually talking about Jesus himself, and we want to talk about that a little bit as well. As well as, you know, the lack of the actual gospel of Jesus of Jesus Christ being preached in the church. And there's a lot of other things that we can get into, but, you know, I'll sidestep some of that stuff and I'll let somebody else talk.
All right. For me, my opening comment, when we talk about church, we often think about what's the word. And words have different meanings. Over time, words change and things like that. So anytime we hear the word church, the first image that comes to our head is that building on the corner. It's not the body of Christ. It's that building on the corner. Now, like you said, we're going to talk about that later on coming up in the show. But that is an aspect that we're going to discuss. And like Jonathan said, people say, you know, it's not my church, it's not my church. Well, if we're all supposed to be one body, if it's happening over there, it is your church. So, go ahead.
Yes, sir. One other thing I really wanted to point out is people always, you know, they will get on us, y'all always so negative. Y'all always got negative stuff to say about the church. Well, y'all ever talk about good stuff? And, you know, we can throw the same thing about us. Y'all know that there's bad things going on, but y'all never say anything about the bad stuff that's going on. It's always my church did this, my church did that. It ain't, you never talk about anything bad, and I get it. We all get it. It's human nature. You ain't going to talk bad about your own church. And then if you do talk about it, you would just say, ain't no perfect church. You know, that's a line. Or you know, just there's no perfect church, or there's no, but you'll never say anything wrong. When you see that, just even with that pastor who slept with all them women, and they were calling the HIV pastor, giving women AIDS and stuff like that. And people still won't say nothing. Creflo Dollar and all this stuff. And people still refuse to talk about it. You know, they refuse to see it. Oh, no, I think they see it. They just don't want to say anything negative about the church. But I think, like John said, you think, or they think that they're talking about Jesus himself. I think they're talking about John himself. So get off of that high horse talking about that we always negative when you don't even see or you refuse to acknowledge the negative stuff that go on in the church. And that's just me. That's just me.
No,
so let's get on. Unless somebody else wanna.
I was gonna say they'll acknowledge it, but they won't do anything about it. They say, yeah, like you said, we know something's wrong. We see it, but they always throw their butts in there. But look at what we're doing. Like you said, but he's just a man. But this, but that.
That's not my church. That's not my pastor.
I will be honest with y'all, man. I don't see a lot of people acknowledging. I don't see a lot of people. I see some people. I can't just totally lie and say that, man. Now that I think about it, that is something by and large, though, outside of the few people that I've encountered that will acknowledge it, man, by and large, man, and I'm willing to bet that it's kind of just like, you know, they don't see it, man. You see what I'm saying? If somebody sees something wrong, and I don't know, man, I'm just not really willing to I'm not willing to say that there are a lot of people that would see the fully understand the scope of what's wrong with something, like the idolatry of pastors and stuff like that, and will continue to be in that situation. You know what I'm saying? Just speaking from my personal experience, I mean, yeah, it did take me a while, even though, you know, my check engine light was on, and I was questioning some things. It took me a while to actually make that step, but I don't know personally a lot of people that are actually seeing what's going on and what's wrong, and are willing to, you know, stay there. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I think what it is people are seeing bits and pieces, but they're not mm-hmm. seeing it as a whole. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
In some churches they may
okay.
see certain aspects, in other churches they may see a certain aspect, but they don't see it as a whole. And
gotcha.
For us, one of the frustrating things is when we are teaching or we're coming against error and heresy, it's like an onion, because they may be talking about this up here at the top, but the answer is at the bottom, and we have to peel each layer off. And so it's kind of frustrating, because if they want to talk about church, then we want to talk about the word church and the ecclesia and what's wrong with going to church, or, you know, we have to explain like a plethora of things. And a lot of times we don't have time. So, you know, it gets frustrating for us.
Okay.
Well,
basically my point was that people are only seeing, you know, a small piece of the pie. They don't see the whole thing.
Right.
Well, not to mention, you know, that cognitive dissonance, you know, you said it last week, Rob, it's a beast. You know what I'm saying? And when you start pointing things out to people, and, you know, their core belief system starts to get messed with, a lot of times psychologically, you know, they will buck and they'll kick against it. And so, you know, when, you know, if a person was to come to them and say, you know, Pastor so-and-so, you know, our pastor, you know, he tried to grope me, or he tried to do this, or he tried to do that, you know, the first thing that comes out your mouth is, well, you know, the pastor that I serve, the pastor that helped me out with my light bill, the pastor who did this and who did that. No, I don't believe that he would do that. I've been with this pastor for 20-plus years, and, you know, I just don't believe that he would do that. You know, next thing you know, you know, there's division in the church now, because, you know, you have a person who's out to get justice for what, you know, just took place against a whole bunch of people that whose cognitive dissonance has kicked in crazy. You know what I'm saying? And next thing you know, you should have protected his anointing, or, you shouldn't have talked about the man of God that way. And now you're on the outside, just like I said, just trying to get some justice, basically.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. So let's get into it. What are some things that are wrong with the church? Andre, you had a lot of stuff you wanted to get off your chest, big bro. Let's hit it up, man. What's some stuff that you see that's wrong with the church that we didn't touch on last week? I'm going to pass the baton on to my brother.
All right. One of the things that, I'll touch on this in the weekend, then we can hit a round table on this for a second. One of the things that I wanted to talk about is whether knowingly or unknowingly, okay, there's a twisting of scripture that takes place in order to maintain certain things in the church. It could be used to maintain a hierarchical structure within the church. It could be used to maintain the belief that tithes and offering could, are supposed to be gathered up by the church. You know, it could be used to maintain the belief that church clergy are supposed to be paid. You know, and things of that nature. So, you know, like for instance, what are some of the scriptures that you guys have come across when you're trying to teach somebody something and, you know, they say, well, no, the Bible says such and such and thus and so, for instance. And this is one of the things that we were talking about just last week, and I guess we can maybe build on that. We were talking about pastors being paid last week. And one of the scriptures that is twisted into making people believe that pastors are to be paid is 1 Corinthians 9, I believe it's verse 11, which states, if you just give me 1 second, 9 and 11, it says, if we have sown unto you spiritual things, is it a great thing if we shall reap your carnal things? Basically, they'll take that scripture and they'll say, well, you know, we've ministered to you the word of God. We prayed with you day and night when your loved one was sick, and all of these other things. And they'll take that and they'll say, now because we've done these things, you know, we're entitled to your money. But if you look at that particular scripture in its entirety, in its context, if you take it from the first verse all the way down, you'll find out that Paul wasn't talking about anybody's money. Paul was talking about food and drink, shelter, you know, things of that nature. Paul was talking about, you know, caring, you know, being cared for while he was out on missionary journeys, basically. And there was, you know, it had nothing to do with money at the time. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, so what are some of the scriptures that you guys have come up with, you know, come up against, rather, that have been twisted and turned around and made you, you know, made people to feel as if, you know, well, this is the way it's supposed to be based on this scripture?
I don't have to know the scripture off the top, but everybody knows the story when Aaron and Miriam talked about Moses' wife, and, you know, Miriam got struck with leprosy.
Numbers 11.
Pastors to use that where they said that, you know, don't talk bad about your man of God or something bad is going to happen to you. You know, little stuff like that. You know, they'll take that and twist it and put themselves in Moses' place, you know. So if you talk bad about me, then something bad going to happen to you, and I ain't got to do it. God going to do it, you know. And that's scare tactics, things like that, man. That's one of the things that I came across that I remember being preached. And another one had to do with Moses with it's a guy named Korah. When he spoke against Moses, and then Moses said, you know, if you die a natural death of man, then God ain't with me. But if you die unnatural death, you know, then you know that God is on my side. And then there's an earthquake, and the earth swallowed up, and him and all his family and all this stuff. And they used that one as well to, you know, not speak against the man of God. And as a scare tactic. And it's crazy. You know, keeping you in your place. Don't talk about me. I'm a man of God. And God will fight my battles. You know, that's one of the things I came across.
Yeah, I mean,
for me, one of the things. Go ahead,
John. No, you good. You got it.
All right. For me, well, a lot of scriptures that we come across often is the test not my anointed, do my prophet no harm.
Right.
I think it's in. Is it in Second Chronicles? First Chronicles? It's in two places, and also in the book of Psalm, I think. It's in two places, and they take it when you say something or when you show the error of these teachers and these apostles and these prophets and these whatever they want to call themselves, these bishops and arch apostles or whatever they call themselves, the first thing that want to come out of the people's mouth, and sometimes their mouth, is touch not my anointed to do my prophet no harm. As if when that scripture was written, it was specifically telling us not to say anything or not to expose any of the dirty deeds that these so-called men and women of God that they place themselves in, we can't expose their deeds. And if we do, you are wrong. God said, touch not his anointed and do his prophets no harm. So you're wrong for that. Keep your mouth off the man of God. You understand that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
It's 1 Chronicles 16:22 and Psalms 105:15. Those are the two scriptures.
Mm-hmm. Keep your mouth off. I never did like that particular term, you know, putting your mouth on the man or woman of God. That's just sexual sounding in nature. I can't do it.
It just sounds stupid. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I see where you're coming from, but it just, you know, more than anything else, it just sounds dumb. You know, don't put your mouth on the, you know, don't put your mouth on the man of God. Don't put, you know what I'm saying? It's just ignorant, man. And you know, those scriptures are definitely used way out of context, and it's an escape hatch, man. It's an escape mechanism when people don't want to acknowledge that the person that they're looking up to, their quote-unquote spiritual leader, they don't want to acknowledge that they might be teaching error, man, or anything like that. So, you know, people, when that is happening, when somebody that they look up to, when their errors are being exposed or whatever, they automatically look at it as an attack. It's like a personal. They take it personally. They look at it as a personal attack because you're attacking somebody that they love, that they look up to, somebody that they put so much emotional investment in. I mean, you have to people are idolizing these leaders, man. I mean, it's an emotional thing. It's, you know, they really love these people, and the fact that they look up to them as a leader is that. It's that they submitted a portion of control over them spiritually. You understand what I'm saying? So,
yeah.
When you point out some error, man, they take it very personally. So they don't want to acknowledge that they might be teaching error. So rather than look at it objectively and say, well, let me see what they taught, and well, let me see what they're saying as far as what the scriptures are saying. They don't want to do it, man. It's just like, like you said, the cognitive dissonance kicks in, man, and they just refuse to see it. They refuse to see it. So the first thing that comes out of their mouth is touch not my anointed. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. And I'm saying, especially if that quote-unquote man or woman of God has done something for that person. You know what I'm saying? Say they out of a tough situation, or, you know, maybe they prayed for them, and what did they pray for happened? You know, then they feel beholden to them. They feel like they have to protect them as if, I'm not going to say that, but they feel beholden to this person for some reason because they helped me out. They did this for me. Now I have to defend them and protect them. And they personalize it. You know, and it's like we talked about in a few shows ago, idolatry, pastor worship. You know, be it a man
right.
or a
it's
woman,
understandable.
It doesn't matter.
Right, it's
right.
very
it is
understandable. But it don't make it right.
Yeah. Have you ever noticed how when you, especially like on Facebook or even in person, if you was to talk about something that's wrong with a particular pastor or point out an error, a particular error with a pastor, have you ever noticed how the Peters come out? In other words, under normal circumstances, that pastor, that prophet, that apostle, whomever it is, they won't say anything. But every member of the of their congregation and their friends will have everything to say about what you just said. They won't have to say a word.
They'll defend themselves, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And when
that's
you were saying
out there.
About, hold on, I'm sorry. When you were saying about you know, them, you know, the pastors, quote unquote, doing something for them. You know what a lot of people equate to doing something for them? If they went to that church and in that church they gave their lives to the Lord, you understand what I'm saying? They, a lot of times they look at the pastor, they look at the pastor as the person that saved them or led them to Christ. And there, and there's that built-in blind loyalty. What they're doing is they're taking Christ all the way out of the equation. You understand what I'm saying? And they're being so loyal to that person because they look at that person as the person that led them to Christ. And that person, that pastor might not have even dealt with them directly, but they started going to this church and they're under this pastor. And under this pastor, they feel like they rededicated or dedicated their lives to the Lord. So then they're looking at that pastor with that loyalty. So they feel like the pastor did that for them. You understand what I'm saying? That's where that touch not my anointing also comes from. Is that, that blind built-in loyalty, man.
Yeah.
Right.
Let's,
you know, this,
what about...
Oh, go ahead. Go ahead.
I would say, what about the spiritual growth aspect of church and your life and how you're growing and what you're learning and how you see a lot of babes, not just in the pulpit, but a lot of babes that are still sitting in the pews Sunday after Sunday, month after month, year after year, decade after decade, and they still are in the same place spiritually because they're not really growing spiritually. But they believe because they go to church and they get a high, so to speak, in the spirit, and they believe that God really moved, but they still in the same place spiritually. All they know is milk. And I believe that this is a big issue within the body of Christ because a lot of times they're not allowed to engage. The only engaging they're allowed to do is say, preach, preacher. They're allowed to shout. They're allowed to sing with the praise and worship team or sing while the praise and worship team is singing. I'm not talking about the people who are on the praise and worship team or the people who are in leadership. I'm talking about the regular members who go to the church daily, not daily but weekly, and they are subject to the learning of one person or maybe a few different people. But if the pastor allows other people to preach, and I'm not going to say this is every church because it wasn't like that in my church, but he's going to make sure that what you're speaking is some stuff that he will speak. You're not going to be allowed to say anything contradictory or contrary to what the pastor would say. And the people who sit in the pews are not allowed to actually engage in their spiritual growth. They have to sit and listen and be spectators instead of participators in their own spiritual growth, and people can, they cannot, I don't care what you say, you cannot deny that. So oftentimes I'll tell people, I graduated from church. I graduated. But how many people have been going to the same church year after year and still don't know nothing? Now, I had a conversation with my wife a while ago, and one of her old churches that she was going to. And I was talking about when I was a little hothead, and I was asking her, why are you going to church? And I was trying to get her to stop. But I asked her the good questions. Like, okay, so you've been going to this church. You like to praise and worship. You like to hear testimonies. But are you growing spiritually? Are you growing? Are you learning anything new? You've been going here for about 2 years. Have you learned anything that you didn't know since you've been here? Learn anything new? What, you know, have they showed you anything in the spirit, so to speak, that you didn't already know? And her answer was, she was honest. She said no. So I asked her, why are you still going? Because she said she enjoys the fellowship. She enjoys the praise and worship. She enjoys the testimonies. But if you ain't growing, I thought the purpose of coming together and the purpose of Ephesians, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, was to equip you for the work of the ministry. But if you've been in this church for 2 years and they not haven't equipped you, then there's a problem. There is a problem.
That's people, we have to wake up.
We have to realize it. I'm just speaking to the people in the pews who may be listening to this show. You know, this is for the people who are in the pews who may be listening right now. Have you learned anything, and I'm not saying that you haven't learned anything, because I don't know what you've learned, but you should be moving progressively and to the deeper things of God. Instead of keep hearing this milk, you know, y'all talk about faith every week. You talk about getting over every week. But what about the deeper things of God? When are you going to learn that? To get out and start your own ministry. I ain't say your own church, but start your own ministry. Because that's what it's for. That's why you're supposed to be meeting with these evangelists and pastors and teachers to help you grow, to edify you, to lift you up, to make you go spiritually. But I don't see it happening. It may happen. It's rare. But I don't know. I don't know. And I guess even when you go to these seminaries and Bible colleges and stuff, you're learning what they want you to learn. And you're going to regurgitate what you've been taught. And if you can regurgitate it well enough to pass the test, then you're good. Then you're good. I mean,
yeah, for me,
anybody
yeah,
else got any thoughts on that?
Yeah, definitely. And think about it like this. In the church, the way the system is set up, but the way the system is set up, it's set up so that the growth of the body is hindered, because the only person or persons that's allowed to, quote-unquote, exercise their gift are those in leadership. Now, the lay members may get an opportunity to do something here and there, but for the most part, they're not allowed to exercise their gift if they even know what their gift is. And a lot of people don't know what their gift is. Why? Because they're passive spectators, like Jonathan said, in their growth. They don't know what their gift is there. Like you said, they're not allowed to engage. Now, some churches, they get a time, what they call ministry time, and everybody gets to get involved. But that's only probably maybe a five-minute process. It's kind of like an altar call. That's what they do in some churches. But for the most part, they aren't allowed to exercise their gift on a daily basis, which we should be doing. The only time they do it is on Sunday mornings. So that's why the church growth is stunted, because the people aren't exercising. It's like a muscle. You got to work that muscle. And the more you do it, the more you use it, the better you get at it. And I remember when I first got my 360 waves in my hair, and the dude was like, you have to train your hair, and your arms don't get tired at first, but then it's going to go into muscle memory, so you do it second nature. And that's what happens. When you start doing it more and more, the easier it becomes. But if you are never allowed to practice or to exercise your gift, you will stay a baby, and you will still continue to drink the sincere milk of the word, and you won't be ready for meat. Because you'll choke on it. And if somebody tries to give you some meat, you reject it.
Right. Yep. That's great. That's great. Listen, there's another part of that keeps growth stunted in people, okay? In the first century church, what took place back then was, if you do your reading, you find out that there were people who they gathered in homes, parks, wherever. You understand what I'm saying? And they were able to not monologue, but dialogue with each other. Okay. They were able to bounce ideas off of other people. They were able to talk with other people and get feedback from what they were talking about, okay? In church today, you don't see this, okay? The church furniture is set up where you have people who are faced one way, and it's usually towards a pulpit. And that pulpit is usually the centerpiece of and the focus of their attention. So if you have everyone focused in that one direction at that one spot, okay, there's no dialogue that's taking place because everyone is listening to one person
at the same time. I can't talk to the person that's next to me. I can't talk to the person who's in front of me or who's in back of me. Okay? I can only listen to what's coming from the pulpit. Now, iron sharpens iron. Okay? In order for us to be able to learn and grow, okay, we need active dialogue. We need people who's going to listen, but we also need people who are going to speak as well, because I can learn more from a conversation with you guys than I can ever learn from somebody snotting and spitting on the microphone with all the music so loud that you can barely hear what's going on. And the next day, you ask someone, well, how was church? Oh, church was banging. It was off the hook. What did he preach about? I don't remember, but it was off the hook. You ain't learned nothing. You didn't have an opportunity to ask that pastor any questions about what they were preaching about or what they were teaching about. That's my two cents.
I got another question, too. Is there anything wrong when the churches had their Bible studies? And that's what people will say, well, that's what Bible study is for, Andre. But, you know, that's another big thing right there. But is there anything wrong when churches have these booklets, these Bible study books and Sunday school booklets that they go through? Is that a form of learning and teaching people? Is anything wrong with that? Is it really helpful? Because we never had that in the church.
In other words, is there anything wrong with the mini sermon that comes in the middle of the week? Because that's basically all that is. It's nothing more than just another it's another venue that a person is able to preach the word of God. But you know, if you can ask questions, because I've known that in some Bible studies you can't ask questions. Because it's styled just like a sermon. But if you can ask questions, okay, the person is very unknowledgeable about what they're talking about anyway. There's been plenty of Bible studies that I've gone to that the preacher is teaching the Bible study, okay, and they're getting the people emotionally involved in the Bible study. Especially towards the end, okay? And you know what happens every time those emotions get riled up, you know what I'm saying? Everything goes out the window. So if you were learning something, you know, unless you take the notes, you don't forget it anyway. But usually,
you know,
the Bible study during the week is just a mini sermon.
Now, sometimes they will allow for questions and remarks or comments, but most of the comments are made to back up what's being preached. You really can't ask any challenging questions, because if you do, you'll be looked at crazy, like you're challenging authority. You know, you can't challenge teaching. It depends on who's teaching, too. Right, because sometimes it's not the pastor's teaching, it's one of the elders or something like that. And you may question them, but when the pastor's preaching, you're not going to question what he says. Because no matter what he says, he's going to have an answer. Very seldom a pastor say, I don't know. Very, very, very seldom you'll hear a pastor say, I don't know. But they will give you an answer.
That's right.
It might not be the right one, but you're going to get one. And like
right.
I said, but the comments, in some Bible studies, you are allowed to make comments, but most of them aren't comments to the contrary of what's being taught.
Yeah, sometimes those comments will be somewhere along the lines of, Pastor, you know, that is so true because I was just studying such and such and thus and so.
Yeah,
funny.
It just comes in agreement with what was being taught.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Man, what about? So, you know, since we all know, you know, what they're teaching and preaching, what about the messages themselves? that these pastors are preaching. Because they're mainly self-help messages, how to get over it. You got to get yours. If you want this from God, you must do this. It's always self-centered, man-centered type of messages. You know, God going to get you through. Keep on pushing. You're going to make it. I mean, it for the most part, it deals with that. How to do something. Not about what Christ did. Not about this, not about that, but only about stuff that's going to make you a better person. Now, in and of itself, there's nothing wrong with that. But is that the purpose of your Christian meeting? To learn how to get over issues? Is that the purpose? But is that the purpose for self-help, motivational speaking? And like I said, in and of itself, there's nothing wrong with that. But that's not why you should be going to church and learn how to get over. Because once you know who you are in Christ, then you know that trials are going to come, things are going to come. And you know who God is, and you know who you are in Him. But you should be coming together to learn more of Him and how He works, not just something to make your life better. Because we got this in our Western church's worldview, we got this mentality that everything is peachy keen in the body of Christ, that your life's supposed to be amazing and it's supposed to be whole. And that's not true. You're never supposed to be sick and all this stuff, man. But Paul talked about he had a thorn in his flesh, and he prayed to God three times, and God said, nah. My grace is sufficient for you. But we think that we ain't supposed to have no issues, no problems. But Jesus said, if you suffer with me, you're going to reign with me. Mm. I mean, persecution is a part of being a Christian. But we ain't supposed to have no persecution. That's a false sense of it. And also, I want to get on this, so remind me later on, let's talk about these false conversions that are happening in these churches and these dual conversions that take place at a lot of these altar calls. So I want to remind me to bring that back up. So anybody got anything else? Because we do have a caller.
Yes. Yeah, I definitely do. Let's make this real quick. Like you were saying, when you come together for your meeting, what's the purpose of it? The purpose of it is to come together so we can share with each other. Not to get information to share to us when we can't share our information. And when we share information together and we hear about each other's struggles and we hear how Christ has brought us through those struggles, it strengthens our faith. It binds us closer together as a family because, man, he's going through that. You know, and you start to feel empathy for your brother or sister, and you see what you can do to help, and then they're grateful, and then when your time comes to struggle, you know, they know that you're struggling because you're there with them, and you talk about it, and they'll pay you back, you know, when it's your turn to go through, and that's what it's supposed to be. But is that really happening in church today? Is that really happening at all? Now, they may do it every now and then. They may throw a church picnic or go bowling or do something like that, but Is that your business meeting? Is that your stated meeting?
Well, you know what, man? It's interesting that you said that. Is it a business meeting? I mean, because if you think about it, man, think about it. Like Nathan just said, it's a lot of what you hear are topical, self-help type. And I hesitate to even call them sermons, man. But really, they are by definition they're
monologues
because you got one person up there monologuing. It's just one person talking. You're passively sitting down, chairs oriented towards the stage where that person is elevated. All of that stuff is symbolic, and you're sitting there just listening and taking it in. So by definition, they're all sermons, but a lot of these quote unquote self-help sermons, all of these topical sermons that these pastors come up with where they just come up with their own particular topic or subject that they want to discuss, and then they throw two or three scriptures in it, rather than what should be the norm instead of the exception, which is expository teaching, which is line-by-line examination of the scriptures and what the scripture is saying. You understand what I'm saying? So when you say that a lot of these speeches and, you know, sermons are self-help basically speeches, you're right. And you know why? That's because there's a lot of this new age type philosophy going on inside the church, man, where if you listen to a lot of these new age people that are on YouTube or got their own podcasts or whatever, and a lot of them not only do they not believe in Christ, but some of them actually hate Christ. You understand what I'm saying? So when you listen to them, and then you listen to a lot of these topical sermons going on in these churches, a lot of it sounds exactly the same. If you didn't know that one of them was speaking inside a church, if you listened to some of these people and didn't know that they're speaking inside a church, you know, some of them could sound just like these new age people. You understand what I'm saying? That's the only thing that's separating them, is that some of them are speaking inside churches. So when you take the focus off of Christ, man, when you take the focus off Christ, and when it's not an actual fellowship, when you're actually sharing, it becomes this new age stuff that's, I mean, really prevalent inside the church system today. And it's across denominations, man. It's like really prevalent inside the church. And scripture is replete with warnings about this type of stuff. So when we're talking about what's wrong with the church, these are the types of things that we're talking about. And scripture even warns us about it. So we're not making it up. But then we're looked at as the people that are on the outside. You know, it's like we're abnormal. Something's wrong with us. But, hey,
right.
It is what it is.
You know, real quick, because I know we got a caller. 1 Corinthians 4, Paul says that we preach Christ. Okay? Mm-hmm. That's what should be preached. Problem is, preaching Christ to people who already know Christ, it becomes redundant. So now what they have to do is they have to preach something other than Christ in order to keep people's attention. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And we all know that everybody at some point, if not now, at some point in the future, is going to go through something. Okay? So what happens? We start preaching the survivalist gospel. You know what I'm saying? You can make it if you just hold on. You start preaching the prosperity gospel. You know, you give God some money will come to you. In order to break that monotony, what's happening is that people are grabbing onto that rather than grabbing onto the fact that Jesus saves.
Right.
And it's ridiculous. Right.
Yep. Agreed, bro.
All right. Call, I think we lost a caller. 412, you can call back. 412, call back. We'll get you back on. Go ahead, Andre. Finish your thought, man.
No, that was it. That was it.
Okay. Go ahead and talk about your altar calls and false conversions, Jonathan. Oh, okay. A lot of these, you know, when you altar call, that's another thing that's wrong with the church, because you won't find anything even remotely similar to altar call in Scripture. Nothing. And it usually happens towards the end of the church, end of the service, right before they say the benediction and go home. They call it altar call, where they will stand up and call people forth who wants to be saved. Anybody wants to give their life to Christ, make a decision for God. So, you know, they'll say either doors of the church are open. Will you come? Is there one? And they'll wait a few minutes. They'll try to, sometimes they'll use scare tactics, you know, don't leave out of here, because if you leave out and die, you know, you don't know what happened to you. You know, make sure you write with God. And sometimes they just try to sweeten the pot. Jesus is so good, you know, he can heal all your wounds and all this stuff. So come on down, give your life to Christ. Is there one? You know, sometimes they want everybody to bow their heads, bow your head, all heads bowed and eyes closed. And anybody wants to get their life to Christ, come on down. No, it's an altar call, basically a call to the altar to give your life to Christ. And they have people down there to pray for you, the ministers, even, and if you're lucky, the pastor himself will pray for you. He'd be the one to lay hands on you and lead you in the Lord's Prayer. And that happened to me on three different occasions, three different weeks, back to back to back. I went to three different churches, went down to the altar call three different times, and joined those three different churches back to back to back. I know one of them was a Baptist church, the other was a Kojic, and I can't remember what the other one was. But I actually went down to the altar call, gave my life to Christ on three different occasions, you know, and said I wanted to become a member and never went back to that church again. It happened three different times. But according to them, I got saved. That's a false conversion. It's a false conversion.
You fell for the membership drive.
There's a membership drive, but it was a false. But to them, and even sometimes even in my heart, I felt like, oh, yeah, I'm really saved now. So I felt good for a little while. But here come Tuesday, and it's wing day at BW3s, and, you know, that's where the women used to be at. So I don't went to BW3s to get my little wing day, get the cheap wings and, a lot of women always up in BW3s. I was a single man. Yeah. You know, let me buy you some wings, girl. You like them hot? Yeah, you know. Here we go. So come back on next Sunday. Do it again. But I wasn't never really converted to Christ because I didn't, and I never really accepted him. It was church protocol. I was afraid. Not afraid. Actually, I like the attention. I'm just going to keep it real. I like the attention. When I was going down, and people start clapping, and they were jumping, yay, Jesus, and you know, people was happy, and the angels are rejoicing because one sinner has come back to God. Man, I love that. People was looking at me. They were looking at me. Yeah. I was an attention whore, too. Now, how many people like that? How many people have you seen in churches that go down to the altar call every Sunday to get saved again or to repent every week? They had the altar call for the same old thing.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them might think they're really getting delivered, not just the altar call for salvation, but even for deliverance. They want to get paid, prayed.
Yeah.
The altar call has some real serious issues. Come and pray over week after week. And then they go, if you're so powerful in the ministry, how come I ain't delivered? How come I keep coming down here every week? How come Sister Kim over there every week? Sister Kim is over here crying and snotting and passing out. Every time you lay hands, you just fall out. Every time.
It's something they doing. It's not my ministry. It's them. They're not being obedient.
Right. Right. But you're powerful, though. You're a powerful man in the Lord. You're anointed. You're anointed for deliverance. But you can't get over that person's will, huh? I'm just saying, man, these altar calls with the deliverance and these false conversions, and also we'll talk about the dual conversion as well. The dual conversions, you know, where you have, you know, some people that actually do get saved for Christ, and you know, they actually do get a life to Christ seriously, but then immediately they're converted to the church, culture and churchianity. So you have this thing where you did come to Christ, but then you came also to the church, and they kind of took over your life, where the traditions of men take over, and Christ gets pushed
right
to the back burner. Christ gets pushed to the back burner. We got a couple of callers, guys. Let's go ahead. We don't want them to hang up like 412 did. Area code 609, you are live on Real Talk Radio, 609.
Praise the Lord.
Now, praise the Lord.
What's going on, sis?
The Lord. My name is Prophetess Letitia, and I know exactly what you're talking about because I have endured the worst horrific atrocity of my life, and the church was not there to support me. God had taught me about deliverance ministry. I asked to do deliverance ministry at a well-known church that God told me to go to, and they completely ignored me. Actually, they don't even want me in the church. I was told that we don't do this here. I'm like, what do you mean you don't do this here? This is the word of God. And the pastor, I went up for prayer because I was very, very sick. He laid hands on everyone else except me, the pastor. And he's a well-known pastor.
What's his laid name? Hands on everybody but you?
Yeah, except me. And I went to one of the associate pastors, and he laid hands on me. Everybody else was falling out. I'm looking around. I'm still standing up because I did not feel any anointing from him. And years later, recently, I told him, God did not send you to be a pastor. You cannot be a pastor. You were not called to be a pastor. And he got real mad because he went up against me. And I told him, and I wrote in a letter, I said, this person, just because he is a family member, he was not called to be a pastor, and he is still a pastor because he is a family member of the pastor. He has no anointing. None.
That's crazy.
And they're mad because I'm speaking the truth in love. I've been assaulted in the church. They called the police on me in the church.
Like, what?
I had witnesses. The whole church saw. God told me to stand right there. They called the police on me. Twice.
Wow.
But taking my money.
Did you get arrested?
Taking my tithes and offerings. And I said, I'm giving my tithes and offerings. I said, I'm supposed to talk to the pastor. I was told, you keep yourself. Wrote me a little nasty letter. If I publicize this letter, this person's reputation will go down tremendously. And God is tired of people who are proclaiming that they are his people, and they are not. They are wolves in sheep's. I mean,
wolves in sheep's clothing.
Yes, that's what they are. The police was called. They called the police on me. I was just sitting there. I said, well, you haven't told me I can't come into the church. But they did this all before the pastor got there. I said, no, I gave my tithes and offering. God told me to come to this church, and I'm not leaving. He's calling the police. I sent them a cease and desist letter. The pastor still hasn't called me. I said, no, I am doing what the Bible says. The Bible, there's no such thing as associate pastor. There's nothing. He is the pastor of the church. I'm the one. I came to church because God sent me to the church because of his calling, not no one else in the church. I don't care. I went through all his protocols. I said, I went through all your protocols. What you mean I can't talk to the pastor? I never heard of such a thing in my life.
Yeah, you know what? That's really unfortunate, sister, that happened to you. And, you know, we appreciate your call. Thanks a whole lot for calling in. That's unfortunate, man, you know, that happened. But that you know, speaks to a lot of that, you know, what I heard was a lot of that false conversion stuff, man, that you were talking about earlier. And just what it sounded like on that, you know, with that story, man, it just sounded like just another aspect of what's wrong with the church system, meaning that what I was gathering, if you guys can correct me, what I was gathering was that was just an empire basically built unto that person. I mean, he had A whole lot of other people that were insulating him with mad church disease. You know, you can't get to the pastor. You got to go through these people. You know what I'm saying? Like it's The Wire or something. Like the pastor is Avon Barksdale. You see what I'm saying? It's just the system is the system corrupts people, man. The system, we say that almost every show. The system corrupts people. So you got this quote unquote kingpin, and Elgin always relates the church system to the drug game, man. And it, you know, it may sound offensive to some people, but it's the truth. When you really look at it, it's like the drug game, because the pastor is the Don. He's, you know what I'm saying, Don Corleone. He's Avon Barksdale. He's Nico Brown. He's the kingpin. You feel me? And just like that sister was saying, man, you know, he insulates himself with these people, man. You can't get to the pastor, huh? Then you got to go between.
Yeah.
They got all types of power.
Bad.
It's crazy, man. Go ahead. No, go ahead. I'm done.
Yeah, I'm saying something else, too, that goes to her point, what she was saying, that what's wrong with the church is they're going to kill a messenger.
Right.
a messenger. She said she had a word for the Lord and she wanted to do this and help implement. She came to help the church, but that we don't do this here. They're going to call the police on her? Kill a messenger. Just like they killed the prophets of old. You know, this young lady said she was a prophetess. They will kill them. You know, you're going to mess up what we did. You're trying to mess up. We got a good thing going on here. We don't want you up in here. You got to go. And guess
right.
what? When you at least man, you going against the swimming against upstream, going against it. Oh yeah, you got to go. You got to go. We got
these
to
are the men of the Most High God. These are the men of the Most High God. Y'all remember that story? Go ahead, get the calls.
Yeah, we do. Area code 405-405. You're live on Real Talk Radio.
What's up, guys?
What's going on?
Hey, what's happening?
What's up?
The topic, I'm the guy that called last week and said I was spiritually retarded while I was in the church. When I think about the IC, it seems like to me that IC is basically a man-centered gospel just wrapped in Christian terminology to make it more believable. That's why they tell the people that they is a seed, and we all know that a seed is the word of God. They preach to I think the greedy part of man as opposed to his conscience, so rather than preaching life eternal, I think many of them are preaching life enhancement. Rather than preaching deliverance from sin and hell, they preach deliverance from suffering and hurt. See, these folks, these pimps serve the flesh and the God of mammon as opposed to the Spirit of God. That's why they keep calling on their God. You done heard some of them say, money cometh to me now. You done heard it?
Me right now.
I think these are the people that Paul was talking about when he said they are men of corrupt minds and destitute of truth, who suppose that godliness is a means of gain. Now, I don't want anybody out there to misunderstand me. The problem is not with the tool of money. Jesus didn't think of money as being evil, just the worship or the love of it. So money is not the problem, but rather it's with this perverted, jacked-up doctrine that's really just a cloak of covenants disguised as the gospel. It's a doctrine where Christians are being taught giving to get is God's will. It's a doctrine that glorifies out of mammon and leads folk to seek ye a new house or a car instead of the kingdom of God. See, I think that these people fall to the enemy's trap of viewing people's wealth, influence, and power as an indication of their faith or position with God. God said you would know them by their fruit. He ain't said nothing about you knowing by their money. Last time I checked, money wasn't fruit of the Spirit. See, these folks have drunk Kool-Aid. They've been bamboozled, they've been manipulated, deceived into thinking that the windows of heaven would open and give them this financial miracle or this miracle debt relief if they just send for their anointed handkerchief or miracle spring water, they tithe of their money, if they name and claim it and pay enough money to these greedy gut jelly belly preachers who are just simply lying spirits of the enemy. When I look at the church, what I see is people paying money to get rich and have the windows of heaven open to them. The only problem, brothers, is that they're praying for what is free, according to Isaiah 1. You don't need no money for spiritual blessings. When it comes, I'm going to get off this my soapbox, and I'm going to go, God. When it comes to the windows of heaven, in my opinion, Jesus broke the windows of heaven wider when he said it's finished, because his shed blood gives us access to heaven. I'm finished, brother. I love you guys.
That's right.
I holler.
Hey,
all
man.
Right. Appreciate
thanks
it.
For your call.
That brother.
Appreciate your call. Yeah, man. You know, they're going to windows of heaven again, man. Just like you said, people are going to church and paying to get rich. It's amazing. Church is the biggest pyramid scheme, multi-level marketing scheme that exists, man. Because that's what's being taught, man. You have to pay, you got to pay into it. You got to tithe and all this type of stuff and the windows of heaven and blase, blase, blah. It's just all of it is a bunch of false doctrine that cannot be supported in scripture. Because, you know, we all, man, I hate to even go into it, but we know the windows of heaven was rain, man. It's literally rain.
Yeah.
It's not a magic portal to rain money and cars and houses and husbands and wives and all that type of foolishness, you know what I'm saying, on people, man. And what this prosperity gospel and what this stuff does, man, and the false doctrine of tithing, it has people sitting in church just, you know, trying to seek God for what God can give them material. And they're not, if you're being real with yourself and you're sitting under that type of teaching, man, that's what you're there for. You can go in there and scream and run up and down the aisles and raise your hands and yell and scream and cry and snot during praise and worship all you want to. You can sing just as loud as you want to. You can scream Jesus all you want to. But if you're being real with yourself, a lot of people are in church just for what God can give them material. I'm not making a blanket statement, but that's what that prosperity gospel teaches, man. So if a lot of people are going to one of those churches and they're really internalizing that doctrine, that's what you're in church for. See what I'm saying? Crazy, man.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just so frustrating when, you know, when you're trying to show somebody the truth about the fact, you know, about you shouldn't have to give, you don't have to bribe God with money to get anything. And they will, like, swear up and down that God done blessed him. I gave this money, I tithe faithfully, and God has blessed me. Or because I tithe now, you know, my car broke down, but then somebody paid for it to get fixed or something. Something always happened. I got this check back from my insurance company because I overpaid them, and that happened because I paid my tithes. You know, it's frustrating. You know, and how do you really talk to somebody who is so blind to the fact, or so deceived, where they feel like they have to give cash money in order for God to do something for them? But you really ain't
right.
Giving it to God. Go back and listen to our show, Giving to God. We did our show, Giving
right.
to God. But let me get the soapbox, get this other caller, man. Caller's been very patient. 412, we appreciate your patience. Thank you for holding. You are live on Real Talk Radio.
Hey, y'all hear me?
Hey, what's up?
Yeah, we got you.
Hey, great, great discussion. I really can appreciate also the woman I called a little bit ago. I just want to encourage her. That's really bold to tell somebody to their face that they're not called to pastor. That's a blessing. That blessed my soul. That really blessed my soul. I just want to tell
right.
her, hey, you know, let God continue to do a work in you. He's not done yet, and, you know, don't fight it. Just go with it. And I don't know. We're going to see what the end going to be. But I just wanted to say I really appreciate this topic. I was in the hair salon a couple days ago, and, you know, of course, in the hair salon, for women especially, is where a lot of church talk goes on and, you know, what's happening in their church and whose pastor is doing this and did you notice such and such went to, you know, switch churches and, you know, a lot of stuff. And I really do try to stay out of it. I try to mind my business. And, you know, so, my stylist kept talking. And I said, well, what church do you go to? He was like, oh, you know, I go to Mount Airy. And, you know, Pittsburgh's very small, so there's not going to be that many churches that, especially when you're African-American, that you're going to go to. So I was like, oh, yeah, Pastor Curtis, I'm familiar. But, you know, she was just going on and on about it. And I was just like, yeah, well, you know, it's just okay to me. She's like, but they have so many services, and I like to have options. And I was like, well, that's fine. I guess the thing that I don't get is why do we have all these services and stuff? And, you know, when there's a pastor and there's other churches in that same neighborhood and we're all piled up into this one church on the block, you know, why are we doing that? Well, you know, some people have different personalities and some people just really like this personality. And she asked me which church should I go to, and I said, well, I can't take any of it, so I don't go personally. But if people must go, why are we piling up into, you know, just the popular kids' churches and just skipping over, you know, other people who may really have a call and may really, you know, have, you know, some really sound doctrine. Jesus, you know, they talked about Jesus, and this is what I don't understand about church. Like, they follow, ask, the problem is, it's us. You know, what's wrong with churches? It's us. You know, we like to follow after people that are popular, that are, you know, good-looking. You know, he has to be very good-looking. You know, we like to follow after people who have a track record of material success and that have these material goals and who have a vision for the church, which basically means they have a vision to expand their tent and to expand their barn and to buy property and to have a good marketing plan. You know, all this stuff that you learn at pastors and leadership conferences hosted by people like Jakes and the like. But Jesus never had any of that. This is what I don't understand. Like, Jesus had nothing. Like, he just walked and he talked and they followed him and they listened to him because he spoke with, like, somebody who was in authority, and people didn't understand because he didn't have a formal title. He wasn't a scribe. He wasn't, a Pharisee or, you know, a priest. He didn't have these, you know, these credentials. He just didn't have them. And yet, you know, here nobody knew or nobody realized that he had the most high credential you could ever have because he kept that to himself. And I don't understand how we go from a simple model that Jesus exemplified right there in black and white to what we have today, where we're chasing, you know, like someone said a little bit ago, you know, these pyramid schemes and, you know, trying to get rich just by your attendance and your faithfulness and your works. And, you know, nobody wants to acknowledge that, but that's what it is. You're trying to prove yourself in the ministry so that you can have favor and, you know, and all of this stuff. I don't know where we get all of that stuff. I don't know how over the years that has become our focus, because Jesus didn't have a place to live most of the time, and he still got ministry done. Nobody knew where Jesus was at night. You know, he spoke to Nicodemus, you know, and I think that was one of his night experiences. But for the most part, you know, we don't know where he went to sleep at night. We just know he showed up during the day, and he's walking around, and he's teaching. And he's healing people, and people followed him, and he's making disciples. And it makes me sad when I really think about it, because it looks nothing like what we have today.
Right.
Sure. Looks nothing like it. When we say mad church disease, you think we're being haters, but it's an insidious virus that it, you know, we're trying to help people at least recognize that it's an insidious virus. It's not the model that Jesus had in mind. He would have never, ever, you know, he just would have never, you know, walked around like we walk around today. Mm-hmm. I almost gave Preachers of Detroit, Clarence Langston, I saw the last episode, And I was kind of proud of him that he had been following this one young man that had gone to prison, and he went to pick him up from the prison because the prison released him. He had done 8 months, and he went to go pick him up to meet him as he was released. And I was just like, see, that's, you know, that's real cool. But then he get in the car, you know, he's picking him up in whatever, you know, big SUV, you know, luxury thing he's driving. Nothing wrong with that. But I'm just watching his demeanor, and, you know, he still has on this big, shiny bishop ring and on his pinky finger and, you know, all of this stuff. And I'm just like, why do we have to do all of this? Your ring does not signify, you know, they have those important bishop rings with the special insignia now that, you know, that you are given once you are installed and once you are approved. And I'm just like, you know, where did Jesus do any of this?
Right. Amazing. That's amazing.
And he's the most high. He's the most high. He did none of this stuff. He didn't wear jewelry and all of this stuff and these outlandish robes and, you know, many colors. He rode in on a colt, on a little colt, and they cried Hosanna for him. He went out of his way to be humble. I guess that's what I'm saying. And because he knew who he was, he didn't have low self-esteem, but he went out of his way to make people feel comfortable with him, to let them know, hey, I am with you, and I love you. And I want to see you be made whole. And that's all.
Good point, sis. You're right. I totally agree. You know, like you said, we have to take an honest look at, you know, where a lot of that stuff came from. And when you talk about, we talk about, like, you know, just all of the nonsense religious symbolism as far as the garb and, you know, robes and rings and hats and tassels and all that type of stuff. I mean, we know where that came from, you know, and it's totally unnecessary. Just like you were saying, where did we go from the simplicity of what the first church was all about to having to be dressed a certain way or having to have all of this elaborate buildings and all of this type of stuff? Where did all of that come from? Where did that mentality start creeping in? I mean, you know what I mean? And here it is, 2015. I guess it's so entrenched, but yet and still we have access to more information than we ever have had before. And when you do a search of church history and the scriptures, man, you realize a lot of this stuff isn't necessary. You know what I mean? And it never has been. You know, so.
Right.
I agree with you.
And not just that with the clothing, but even with when you think about all the ceremonies that come along with, you know, when you look at, which I call the nasty bishop, booty bishop or something, with, you know, Wayne
Jackson.
Wayne
Jackson. Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah, Jackson.
Yeah. You know what? All these ceremonies and stuff, you know, where this is how we ordain a bishop, you know, and get down and he'd land on them or humping them. He said he ain't humping them. You know, he said, we got nasty minds, but we see what you're doing on the TV. Anyway, not just that, but when you look at Fred Price, when he got, I guess, installed, for lack of a better word, as an apostle, or even Hezekiah Walker, when he got installed as a bishop, all these things, all these grand ceremonies, these kneeling down and kissing the rings. I actually had to delete my cousin off of my phone from Facebook. It's my own cousin. I got rid of my cousin from Facebook. Now, we had been into it a few times about some Facebook. He's a real church. He's a Kojic pastor. And I seen this man, I seen my cousin, on his knees in front of this man with his head bowed, and this man got his hand on his head, and I was like, I can't take it. That's the last straw. And I had to delete my own cousin. Now, we still talk, you know, but we don't talk about church stuff, and we're not Facebook friends, and we'll never be. But where does this stuff come from? We know where it comes from, but why can't we see that this stuff is so man-made, so man contrived, and we look at it as if it's pleasing to God, as if God is going to be pleased if we didn't have all these ceremonies, that you really won't, you ain't no real bishop now. If you don't wear this garb, if you don't wear the little silver chain with the cross on it and tucking in your pocket, you know, you ain't really a bishop, or you ain't really an apostle, or whatever. You know, I charge you with this, I charge you with that. You know, I was an elder in a church, and we had this deacon, so we had to come up and give charges to the deacons. I charge you as a deacon to do this, and you're going to fulfill it. Where does all this stuff come from? That's another thing, this pomp and circumstance bull crap. It's pomp and circumstance, and it makes make them look good, makes them look important, and you ain't nothing but a man just like me.
No, no, no. No, no, he's not. He's special and important.
Right.
You know, if you listen to these messages on authority, you listen to these messages on authority and spiritual authority and sons and daughters and your spiritual fathers.
Please, no.
I mean, and that's why this woman who called, this courageous woman who called a little while ago and said, you know, that she's had the police called on her and stuff, because they don't recognize persons that are not standing up there as having authority. They just don't. That woman might be saving your life. That woman might be saving your life. She's trying to help you. She's telling you. And I know a lot about how these succession plans work. So she mentioned something about he was in the position because of who he was in their family. And, you know, that's how a lot of these succession plans work when you're talking about passing ministry on from one to another. But at the end of the day, if that person is not really supposed to be a pastor or working in a ministry in that capacity, because, you know, the whole pastor thing is messed up anyway, but you're working somewhere, you're displaced. You're a displaced worker in the body of Christ. She's trying to help you, and you refuse to listen to her because you won't recognize that she's a saint and that she's trying to help equip also.
That's my calling, though.
You're
That's
not
my calling.
To equip the saints. You're not. You're not just because you're a bishop. Just because you have been installed and you went through this pomp and circumstance ceremony, that you are now authorized to equip the saints. That is, none of that is predicated in the Word of God.
Right.
He has made whatever it is that you're called to do to equip the saints and to work in the ministry. It doesn't have all of this stuff, these other things that you made up. So she actually may have a more mature standing in the body of Christ than you do, and yet you're rejecting her because, well, she's not with us.
Oh, because she's a woman, too.
I think she's dangerous.
You know how that is. Go get your husband. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, then there's that. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to take you guys.
What's wrong with the church?
I'm going to call back.
Hang out with us, Margaret.
All right.
Man, what's wrong with the church? What's wrong with the church? But when you're in it, it's hard for you to see it because, you know, in your mind, God is blessing you. And I believe I'm called here. Mm-hmm. And another thing that I have an issue with is when people tie your salvation to your church attendance. Because you don't go to church, then you are somehow a less than Christian. You know, you're beneath us that go to church.
Just because we're not with them doesn't mean that how's that slogan go?
Yeah.
We don't attend with them doesn't mean we're not in him.
Right.
Just because we don't attend with them does not mean that we're not in him.
Right.
That's what to say. But, I mean, they will tie your salvation to your church attendance. You have to go to church, because if you don't go to church, then how are you going to hear the word of God? How are you going to grow? How are you going to do that without? How are you going to hear without a preacher? How are you going to preach unless you've been sent? They take all these things out of context. Oh, my goodness. How are you going to hear without a preacher? So, therefore, I'm a preacher. Now I have to preach. That's my calling. And so you have to be in a church in order to hear from God. You can't learn on your own. And then they throw out these straw man excuses. Well, nobody can learn by themselves. You know, everybody want to be an owl. You want to be a lone wolf. Who said anything about being a lone wolf?
Oh, my God.
Who said anything about not being on the island? Well, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together as is the matter of so. Come on, bro. Who said we ain't assembling?
Mm-hmm.
But those are your quick knee-jerk reactions that you come up with, because you don't really know how to come back. You don't have a comeback, a biblical comeback. So you just say, throw out these little sly remarks. You want to be a lone wolf. No. My salvation has nothing to do with a building.
Right.
Nothing.
You know what, man? Nathan, I'm sorry, man. Nathan, John, you guys may remember a very long and protracted discussion sometime last year on my page, where people like us were being called rogues and lone wolves, and you know, but just because we questioned certain aspects of church leadership, so then we became the outlaws, we became the outcasts, the rogues. I mean, we got called all types of names. And all
rebels.
Types of, you know, rebels, all types of ad hominem attacks in that discussion, because we question aspects of church leadership, or we question church leadership, period. And just like you said, man, our salvation is not tied into what goes on inside church buildings, which is where church leadership wields its power, inside church buildings, inside church services. You see what I'm saying? So we're not subject to that. We're not subject to those rules and regulations that, you know, these churches, these islands unto these people, establish. You know what I'm saying? You know, and our salvation isn't tied up in that. And people inside the IC can't see it. And that cognitive dissonance starts kind of swirling. It really starts aggravating them. So they lash out at us. What are you jealous of? Is there nothing to be jealous of? I mean, because that's what I'm thinking a lot of it is. You know, we're not subjected to quote unquote church leadership, but every time you step foot inside those four walls, you got to, you know, buck and yes sir and do this, that, and the third, and submit yourself to another man. Well, we're submitted to Christ. You understand what I'm saying?
You're
nothing
free.
To be jealous of. Exactly.
But you're free.
Right. Right.
Yep. I think they can't fathom the fact that you call yourself a Christian and don't go to church. How is that possible? You gotta go to church. You're a Christian, you don't go to church. That don't make sense. But then when they start to think about it, like, well, can you be a Christian and not go to church? And that's when you say that cognitive dissonance kicks in. Like, nah, I got to go. Because like John said earlier, when you're there in the midst of it, and even somebody like me, when I'm there, like I go back just for whatever reason, and you're in the midst of it in the praise and worship, which is always fun to me, like it's like, wow, this is fun. I see why people do get trapped in it. It's easy.
Mm-hmm.
It's real easy. It's easy to fall right back into it. But
mm-hmm.
you know, if you're not awake, if you're not woke, then you stuck.
Mm-hmm. Nathan, mm-hmm. like you said, man, it causes division amongst the body, just like you said, bro. You know what I mean? It's an unnecessary division. And let me I'm on my Facebook page, and let me read a status that I just saw a few minutes ago. I'm not going to say the person's name, but this is the type of mentality that we're talking about. This is what we're up against here. So this person says, so here's the deal. I need my real prayer warriors to get on bended knee for me and have a little talk with Jesus. I'm not sure what is going on, but I need some change in my life. I've not been to church in a while, and I've been planning on and wanting to go, but I'm waking up as service starts. I need to get there, so please pray for me. So, what are your
the
what
church
are your
is his
reactions to that? Right.
The church is his savior.
Right.
He's not trying to get to Christ. He's telling you to go to Christ for him, but he's trying to get to church.
Exactly. Exactly.
And
this,
that's the
this
prevailing
so
mindset.
That, right.
Mm-hmm.
There's so much wrong with that, bro. So much wrong with that. And I mean, I feel
and then to, and to even try to address it, that's we know that's going to be a headache for us to even try to address.
Right.
Because I was talking about earlier, that's that onion that you have to peel back so many layers for him to really get to see and understand what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes time.
It's like,
and that's what discipleship is about. Go ahead.
I was saying, it hurts my heart and it vexes my spirit to you know, even hear something like that because, like John said, you're putting your trust in the building. And not in Christ. So that church building is more important than your relationship with Christ. Why do you have to go to church? What is at church that you can't get on your own couch, that you can't get in your own living room from God? Now, granted, you can have fellowship with other saints, and there is, you know, power when you, you know, when you come together with other saints and to pray, but that ain't the reason why you think you need to go to church. You think you need to go to church to hear a word from God, from a man standing in a pulpit in a
that's
nice room.
That's
going to
deliver you.
That's
right,
how you struggle. And that's what vexes
right.
me. So
right.
your church attendance is more important than your relationship with Christ. And it hurts my heart, man.
Right.
And it vexes me to hear things like
that. That is clearly what that status says. They want us to go, they're positioning their friends to pray for them to motivate them to go to church. Well, wait a minute. You didn't ask any of us where we were. You understand what I'm saying? So I could be in Starbucks somewhere, or I could be in Walmart, or I could be in my car driving down 540. You understand what I'm saying? And I could go to Jesus on your behalf. That's fine, right? You don't see a problem with that. But you have to go to church in order to get these questions answered that's swirling around about your life, to get this change that you want. You have to go to church, but you're petitioning us to go to Jesus for you. Why don't you, wherever you are, because Jesus is where you are, go to Jesus yourself on bended knee. You see what I'm saying? Go to Jesus yourself on bended knee. If in the remote chance that you're listening to this broadcast this morning, because it's one of my Facebook friends, go to Jesus on bended knee yourself, because Jesus is where you are. You don't have to – the church does not house – Jesus is not confined. God is not confined to church building. I mean, please, just like Nathan said, it really bothers us when we hear stuff like that.
Right. Another question.
Sorry.
Dre, go ahead, man.
I'm sorry.
John,
it makes it sound as if when you're going to, you know, when you have to go to a church in order to find out what's going on with your life and how to get your life back right and things like that, it sounds like you're going to a psychic, okay, so that you can get a reading, you know what I'm saying, and so that you can find out what's going wrong with your life. I mean, you know, I'm vexed, okay? Just go ahead and pray for yourself, man. A lot of these churches, this is one of the things that I can't stand about churches, that a lot of people have the notion that someone else is more qualified to go to God on your behalf than you can for yourself. You know what I'm saying? You are the most qualified to pray for yourself.
Right.
The most qualified. Besides the Holy Ghost himself.
Mm-hmm. And for me, what I was going to say,
John,
was it's kind of like the struggle And I think there's a lag time or something, and that's why we keep talking over each other. But for me, I think he's wanting to go to church because he's struggling. So his intent is not for a relationship with Christ, but it's for a struggle to end. So what's the, this is Elgin always asks the question, what's motivating you? Because society taught you when you're struggling, you go to church and God going to fix it.
Right.
That's what we taught. God going to fix it, so go to church. And so when you go to church and then your problem, you know, works itself out, then you don't need church no more. You're gone again. You don't need Jesus no more.
That's deep. And you're right, man. You're right. We got to, you know, what are your motivations? You're right. That definitely takes some self-assessment right there. But, you know, just make sure you're not going to, you want to go to church because you're unsure about what's going on in your life. You feel like going to church is going to get you somewhere. Hey.
Mm-hmm. I want to, you know, we talk about something else is wrong with the church and how it creates divisions within families. And so you got one person who loves to go to church and the other person who doesn't, whether they're saved or not. My household, my wife still goes to church. I don't. It's the same thing in my mother-in-law's household. You know, she went to church, but her husband didn't go. It could be vice versa where the man goes, but the woman doesn't go. And don't let either one of them be in ministry. You know, it can cause a huge division because they're like, why are you at this church every day, all day? And I think I'll let Andre speak on that because Andre went through some stuff like that. Andre, speak on it, my brother.
Definitely. I mean, you know,
families.
Yeah, definitely. My struggle basically took place more or less after I left the church, and my wife was still going, and you know, she's in ministry, she's a missionary. I was a minister at the time. And the struggle began, like I said, once I came out of the church and I said, you know, I'm done with this, you know what I'm saying? It started to cause a lot of friction between the both of us because the mentality of my wife was basically no church, no salvation. So as far as she was concerned, if I wasn't in church, I wasn't saved, you know what I'm saying? I need to get back in church. And now, you know, she's calling up the pastor. She's letting the pastor know what's going on. And, you know that was another part of the strain that was in my marriage, the fact that pastor knew more about what was going on in my household than I did. And I'm the husband. You understand what I'm saying? And so, you know, the friction that was caused basically drove us apart because she was dead set on, you know, me being not even so much at another church, but at that particular church. I had to be there. I had to be on hope. I had to, I had to be, you know, because I was a minister. I was an armor bearer. I was a praise and worship leader. I did the multimedia. I did everything in that church, okay? And so, you know, when I left, not only did it cause a collapse in the ministry, all right, but because they were pressuring my wife to talk to me to coming back into the church, and there was a lot of despicable deception that was going on along with that as well. So because they were talking with her trying to get me back in the church, and I'm not going back, and you know I'm not going to the church, you know. It ended up, we sleeping in separate beds, I'm on the couch or in the other room, you know what I'm saying? She don't want nothing to do with me because I'm not back in church. And, you know, it was really hard, it was really crazy until we eventually divorced.
But they speak out against divorces, right? And they probably told her to divorce you.
Say that again?
I said, but they probably speak out against divorce, but they probably told her to divorce you. Because you were an unbeliever and you departed, so it was safe.
Right. Exactly. You know, and the thing about it is that because the pastor was going through her own divorce issues, it was easy for her to say things like that.
Wow.
Now, I kind of went through something similar to that, too. But mine was a little different because I was in ministry. I was in leadership. But my wife, we was in church together. But then when she was like, I ain't going back, she was just through. She knew, she seen it all. I didn't see it, but she seen it all. She was through. But she never stopped me from doing what I needed to do. You know what I'm saying? She never complained I was gone too much. Because when I wasn't there, I still spent time. I just wasn't I still spent time with my family. So I was able to have that balance. So she really didn't care too much. As long as I had my family time. So, but my situation was a little different.
Right.
We got another caller, area code 919. 919, we appreciate your patience. Thanks for calling. You're live on Real Talk Radio.
Hey, good morning, guys. Great discussion this morning. I just wanted I just wanted to bring up a point, and I think it basically touches on what everybody has said, and it's that there seems to be a general lack of humility and a show of love within the church body. As Christians, As Christians, we're supposed to love and help one another, but people seem to be more interested in following a man or a movement instead of getting to know Christ for themselves and spread the gospel. Having a relationship with God is not about building a mega church or gaining a title bestowed by man. It's basically spreading his love and showing that love to others. And if people, having a title of deacon or bishop or ambassador or whatever else it is, doesn't make you a Christian. Doesn't show the fruits of your spirit. And I think for me that's the basic problem. There's no humility and there's no love. And, if you're not a tither, you can't get help from a church. That shouldn't be the way either. So,
that's
it. I'm keeping it short. That's my thing. No love and no humility.
You're right. Wow. She just preached the house down. She just preached the house down. Real short and sweet.
Wow.
Marjorie, I know you want some
ain't
of that,
no
Marjorie.
Love,
what you got to say?
Oh,
ain't
my
no
God.
Love,
that was
church.
Life. You know what? It's so refreshing to hear other people get it, and what she said was such a blessing, and people won't hear it. Some people won't hear it though because, we're the renegades. But she couldn't have put it no simpler. I think that sums it up. I think what's wrong with the church is us. It's us. It's our idolatry. What we like to lift up and say what's important and who's not. It's really horrible. I also called that out at the hair salon. Like, why are we idolizing the musicians? Like, why do they get a special place in pulpit heaven? The rest of us, have to just sit there. And many people are working equally as hard and won't see a dollar, but we idolize the musician, the praise and worship leader, the pastor, and all these people that are up there. It's idolatry.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
I've seen people leave when the organist leaves.
Yeah.
Or when the praise and worship leader gets poached by another ministry, people leave and go with them.
Amazing.
Wow. We got another caller. Area code 770-770. You're live on Real Talk Radio.
Yes, good morning there, Kings. I'm enjoying the conversation. I think the problem is it's not so much the church, it's the ignorance that's being taught. And if you ask the average man where do he fit, he doesn't fit in, because the whole plan is to not give us the awareness of who Christ is. And when you look at today, you find more women coming on saying they're apostles. There is no such thing as apostles in the 21st century. And definitely no woman cannot be an apostle. And so when you find a woman leading a man, that's a body has become a freak, because no body has two heads. The Bible says in Luke 17:21, the kingdom of God is inside of you. And I want to just say, especially among us as men of color, why don't we address each other like kings? If Jesus Christ, the Messiah, was and is the King of Kings, then where's his kings? And I think what's happening is the enemy, the devil, has crept in and made us bitter. Because I used to be very bitter. And then I went into prayer for myself, because we are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. And we all have things that we like and that we're going to worship and idolize and praise, because that's just our human nature until we learn better. But today, we as men, we are not given the opportunity to really be kings, and we don't call each other kings. And Jesus said in the book of Matthew, he came to save his people. And when you talk like that, as a man should talk, you're condemned, you're ostracized. You're called vagabonds. I was put out of the church, and then the pastor called me back saying he made a mistake. No, you didn't make a mistake. It's an organization, which is cool. It's cool for you to be in an organization, but you got to realize wherever you go, if I come to your house, there's rules and regulations. If you go into these buildings, and these buildings don't allow you to learn who Christ is the head. How can a woman be the head? So when she's now been given the position to be a head, then that makes, evidently, you have to be the woman. And this is what's going on today. They have this ill-reputed building, a sepulcher, a dead man's bones, and then the man now, and then they have the law that fights against you. So, especially, not only because this, you know that we are male and female. So there's things that's going on in our nature that we are not addressing. I had a program that I created because of men being hurt because of domestic violence, because of the church, whether it's the mosque, whether it's the synagogue. But the whole thing is that we are not getting the word. And it's a nation that has been set up through a system. It's like when Jesus said to the disciples, go ye therefore and teach all nations. And then in the book of Isaiah, Lucifer tore up the nations. Then you remember, I don't know if you remember, this game we was taught as a child, Mr. Fox, what time is it? Well, Jesus said in the book of Luke, you go tell that fox, it's not yet my time. But fox represents 666. If you count A, B, C, D, E, F, that's 6. If you count A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, O is 15. Anything after 9, you have to add. That's 15, that's 1 plus 5 is 6, and the X is 24. 2 plus 4 is 6, 666. So when you talk about Revelation 13:18, it says, here is wisdom, let him count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. Well, then how did we become so degraded as kings? As kings, see, that's what we have to own up to. We have to, number one, we have to be the king or the man that we are, and we have to make sure that we pick our queens, because some of these queens that's running around here today, man, they've been so hurt, and that's no disrespect to our queens, our women. But this is what ignorance have done to us. And then we have to prospectively put the Bible and read the Bible with an understanding. Paul was a Gentile and a teacher of the Gentile. People say, oh, well, no, Paul wasn't a Gentile. Paul was a Gentile. He never went to Africa. And if we as men don't recapture brother, who we are and where we came from, and it's love. People say, well, God loved everybody. You know, read Malachi 1. Right. Read Romans, the 9th chapter, he said, Jacob I love, but Esau I hate it. But whenever you start standing up to be a man, you're shot down from every angle. So we have to address the issues. We have to tell these women, the queens, you out of order. You out of order. Just straight to the point.
Right.
Jesus didn't play with this.
We appreciate your call.
We
appreciate your call.
Thank you.
We want to stay on topic here. Let's stay on topic, man. Go ahead, Nathan.
What's wrong with the church? I don't know where that went. Getting down on women, but we don't get down on women like that, not on our show. You know, women have a role to play in the body of Christ just like men do. And that's another thing that's wrong. When we want to put women down constantly within the body of Christ and tell them what they can and can't do, and then you want to try to use the Bible to beat people over the head with what women can and cannot do. If you don't believe women to preach or teach, then don't let them preach or teach you. That's you. You have that
see,
right.
Right. Here's the thing, man. We're not talking about women being the head of church bodies because we don't recognize the authority inside church bodies, inside institutionalized church buildings. We don't recognize that authority. So
in general,
right there, we don't we do not recognize that authoritative structure. But if you're telling me that a woman can't preach the gospel, I'm not feeling it. I'm not gonna ride with you on that, bro. Because women are allowed, you know what I'm saying, to teach the gospel. You see what I'm saying? It's no way you can really convince me that a woman cannot be a teacher of the gospel. We're not talking about an authoritative position over men. We ain't talking about all that. You see what I'm saying? So, hey, you know, it is what it is, man.
Mm-hmm. And I'm a king. I'm a servant. I'm a servant.
Right.
I'm a servant. We all should be servants.
Yeah, I guess I wanted to know like where he was going with that too, about treating one another as kings, that, you know, why aren't we treating one another as kings? Like, I didn't know where he was going with that. Because I don't know who's preventing you from treating somebody else as a king. Are you saying that the system is preventing you from treating? Like, I didn't understand.
I mean, we were going all the way. Say it again.
Yeah, I kind of understood where he was going. He was going, and I believe, and somebody correct me, he may be a black Hebrew Israelite. You know, we ain't talking about Gentiles. We ain't talking about none of that stuff. You know, treating the black man this, black man that, and Paul was a Gentile and all. Man, that is not what this show is about. We weren't talking about that today. We were not.
Right.
So
that's what I was hearing.
You're on Blog Talk, that's what your own show, and you can talk about that stuff. But today we're talking about the institutional church that we have today.
Right.
Yeah, he had some good points, but I think he's.
All that numerology stuff. That's where it started going downhill for me. But anyway, continuing the discussion.
Let's get back to this church stuff, man.
Yeah.
So another thing that I have is, you know, with the churches, when they want to bring people back to, you know, say you when they go out, quote unquote, witnessing, a lot of people's priority is not to get you to know Christ, but it's to get you to join their church. It's a membership drive. Because, again, we can go back to it, they believe that joining the church is paramount to your salvation. So if I can get you in the church, then you know, you can get taught a little better. You know, or if I can get you to the church, now it's the pastor's responsibility to teach you what the word of God. Instead of me discipling you, now I'm going to put it on the pastors and the leaders, because I'm just the average pew sitter. I just volunteered for this ministry because I like talking to people. But, you know, once I get them in church, now I'm handing them off to the pastor. No, that ain't how it's supposed to work, but that's how it goes on. These membership drives, invite your family. Was it Friends and Family Day? How often do you have a Friends and Family Day? And we know that's nothing but code word for membership drive.
Yep.
Why do we need membership drives?
Oh, because we want to get more members. Money is number reason.
Why
though?
Like, why can't it ever be that you're supposed to be in this smaller group of 25? Like that's
right.
You know, why aren't you faithful and do the best you can do with one another in the group of 25.
Exactly.
Because it's about what I did for you, God. Mm-hmm.
You want to be a what?
We did all of this.
The moment.
This is why I hate the pastors and leadership conferences, because it's just a big old pimp factory creating more pimps to do what pimps do, to create more people, which is going to create more wealth for you. Has nothing at all to do with carrying out the message of Jesus Christ.
That's right. Right.
Because if you can get more members, then you can be a bigger church, and the bigger church you are, then you can get more members. You can attract more members. And then now you can be a big name amongst your fellow brethren.
But you ain't even taking care of these people. But you know what? But you know what? And I know we're getting close, but these people that want to be in a race to the finish to be so grand and so big so fast, you know, and we read these church fires and how we are ascribing the worth of a clergy person based on how many members they have and how many churches they oversee. And then my question becomes, well, how do we know how much quality that person is giving to any of those entities? And when is the last time you've been to the church you're supposed to be overseeing in Delaware or in Japan, or whatever it is that you say you oversee? Oh, I oversee 500 churches. Okay. Do you know how any of those people are doing?
Exactly.
Yeah. How can you oversee 500 people, let alone 500 churches?
Sure. Yeah, but we just take, you know, we take what they're saying, you know, even though it can't be verified at all. But I like to give people the benefit of the doubt. So you say you oversee 500 churches, then how are these people doing? How come your pastor over there is jacked up, depressed all the time, you know, abusing people? But you don't care because he's on your roster, and you can list him on your website as somebody you oversee. But you ain't giving him oversight. You're not pulling him in. People like Pimp Preacher and Exit Churchianity and, you know, Kojic Watch and all these other blogs and stuff has to oversee your people because you ain't doing it. Nigga, you ain't overseeing these many people. You can't be.
Mm-hmm. I delegate my
overseers. Right. They're overseers. Exactly, Nathan. They're overseers in title. That's it. They're overseers in title. But by flying to this, that, and the third church once a quarter is, come on, man. You understand what I'm saying? Or whatever, however you get down.
Look at this last caller, guys. Last call is 205-205. I think it's Brother D down in Alabama. What's up, bro?
What's good, man? It's me, man. Enjoyed the show. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah,
we can hear you.
Okay. But, yeah, I've enjoyed the conversation and a lot of remarks just kind of sparked some memories and stuff when I was, like, knee-deep in church and being involved in so much. But as much as we go and as much emphasis as they put on the service or quote unquote service, because nobody's really getting served, but you know, the people who hold the mic, because they get a check, the service is over. But they put so much emphasis on the service and the things that go on between the first prayer and the last prayer. But if you really look at it, like, there's no fellowship during that time. The real fellowship that's really done is the fellowship that's done on the way to the cars, if that just so happens to happen. And you have so many people who are content with, once the benediction is over, going to their cars and going home and, like Elle said, get some chicken. And I that's a huge problem. One of the biggest problems is that that there's no fellowship. There's no what I like to call one anothering. People use Hebrews 10:25 to justify or to guilt people into coming to church when they haven't been coming to church, but they don't read the last half of that scripture that says, you know, provoking one another to good works. Like, how much is that happening in church these days? But I think the next thing, the other thing that I see that's difficult or a thing that kind of puts a strain or a hindrance on church growth and just people growth, not numbers, but the growth of people and their spirituality, I think is the separation we have from the preachers and the rest of the church. Because I think it puts position of, okay, I'm not allowed to do anything or I'm not expected to do anything but receive and not put myself in a position of serving or ministering in a certain capacity. So that's my two cents, and I know it's getting about that time, so I'll let you guys finish up.
All right. Appreciate it, brother.
Appreciate you, Paul, man.
Always, bro.
Let's go ahead and end the show on that note. Final thoughts, Rob.
Final thoughts, man. What is wrong with the church? I mean, if anybody has listened to the show for today and last week, or really at any point, and you shared these last couple shows, man. I mean, it's something that. It's something to be said about doing very honest introspection, and just like, you know, like Elgin says a lot, you know, check your motives of why you're still caught up in the system, especially if you are seeing the error, if your check engine light is on, if you are sensing that something is wrong. What's stopping you from questioning things? What's stopping you from, you know, leaving, stopping. And that takes self-assessment, man. And just, you know, sit at the feet of Christ. Just like we always say that just go to Christ and learn from Christ and keep these people out of the middleman position. Keep pastors out of the middleman position. Keep church buildings out of the middleman position, because they're not needed to get to the Father. That's my final thought.
Marjorie?
Hey, I don't know. I just want people to continue to learn and continue to listen to programs like this, honestly. I'm surprised when I talk to people about shows like this and other programs. You know, they're hungry to hear what else is being said, what other people are saying. And I just recommend that you continue to search out truth. And it's not going to be easy to hear at first, but be open to it and allow the Holy Spirit to do the work in you, and not based on the personality of a person, because that's never going to work out for you. Just saying.
Right.
Andre.
Well, yeah,
all right,
Dre.
John. Dre dropped.
All right, what's wrong
John?
With the church?
That's right.
Yeah, what's wrong with the church? Traditions have been place higher than the Word of God. That's what's wrong with church.
Andre.
I'll give my final thought.
I was going to say that we ain't no haters. We don't hate the church. We ain't mad at the church. We just want to expose a lot of the ills that's going on in the church. Hopefully you'll be able to see it one day. Don't just take our words for it. As we always say, don't take anybody's word for it. Go back. Do your research. Look at, if you're in church, look at it for yourselves. Look at some of the things that were said on today. Go back and study the scriptures. See if what you see going on in your church daily and weekly, look for it in scripture. I'm not saying that everything that's in scripture that they had it all right. We're not saying that at all. You know, they had their own issues. But if what you think is going on in your church, if you want to lay it at God's feet and say it's holy and right and godly, then you should be able to find some semblance of it in scripture. Like we talked about the altar call, you should be able to see some sort of altar call in scripture. So study for yourself. Don't take our words for it. We don't hate the church. We ain't mad at the church. And like I said again, we ain't talking about your church unless we're talking about your church. Let's try to bring Andre back one more again. Andre, you here with us, bro?
He with us,
Nah. All right. John, why don't you go ahead and pray us out, please, sir?
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for another opportunity to come before your people to share the knowledge and insight that you have given us. And, Lord, we ask that we were able to plant some seeds and to water some seeds, and we know that you are the one that gives the increase. We ask that someone's mind is open, O God, and we ask that you continue to bless us and to use us. And, Lord, we know not everyone's going to agree, but we know that's not our responsibility. Our responsibility is just to speak the truth in love, and we've done that. And we ask you to continue, O God, to be gracious to us, and we know that you will. And all these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We want to take a chance to thank all of the callers for calling in. We appreciate you guys. Thank you for taking the time out to listen to Real Talk Radio week after week. Thank you for spending your time with us, because we know you could be spending your time in church praising God, but you'd rather fellowship with your boys on Real Talk Radio. We thank you. As always, don't forget, check out our YouTube channel, Facebook page, all that good stuff. But you can find all that information on the website at www.4realtalkradio.com. And tune in on Tuesdays at 12 noon to check out Kingdom of Coffee with Dewan Holion. And we will see you guys next week. Peace.
All right.
Thank you for checking out this episode of Real Talk Radio. Be sure to check out our YouTube channel and Facebook page, or drop us a line at 4realtalkradio@gmail.com. That's the number 4realtalkradio@gmail.com. Man, send your comments, concerns, criticisms, or show ideas. We would love to hear from you. Till next week, we out.